Okay, it's a great pleasure to be here. Thanks to Warren and the organizers for the hard work that goes into events like this. So, in what follows, I'm interested not in an assessment of the direct or experiential effects of psychoactive drugs, whether psychological, social, political, or aesthetic, but instead in the shadow cast by the absorption and reorchestration of their impact in popular or everyday cultures during the 1970s and 80s, as manifest in art practice, two particular formations of art practice. Now, I call what results after effects for several reasons. First, because I will argue that during the initial stages of an obviously contested normalization of drug cultures, especially in American suburbs and high schools, a process that was sutured to unevenly stern and discriminatory regimes of criminalization, we witnessed the construction of new narratives and renegotiations, some consolidating a general misunderstanding of psychotropic discourse that was largely developed by a previous generation. Secondly, my purview is limited to representations of imagery arising both directly and indirectly from psychotropic experience, and is thus removed, possibly several times, from that somewhat mythical construct of the trip itself. This talk, then, is about the transmission, reception, and in a sense, the narrowing of, or even capitulation to, certain boundary conditions of drug-related experience. I will discuss how this channeling connects to other social formations, including but not limited to education, acculturation, coming of age, visionary religious phenomena, and the reorganization of aesthetic codes during the 70s and 80s. Now, these concerns are overlaid historically by the prosecution of what US President Richard Nixon notoriously termed the war on drugs in June 1971, a hardline reassertion of the Comprehensive Drug Abuse Prevention and Control Act of 1970, then the latest salvo of a cycle of legislative prohibitionism that commenced with the Harrison Narcotics Tax Act of 1914, and a number of other initiatives, local initiatives for the main part, in the mid-19th century. That these efforts were exploited by a cynically reactive rightist rail politique is attested by Republican insiders such as John Ehrlichman, who claimed that the war on drugs specifically targeted and criminalized blacks, minorities, hippies, and the anti-war left in what amounted to a counter-cultural crusade. Now, the work I attend to here is colored by the anti-utopian turn signaled by Nixon's attempt to strangle and eclipse what could still be perceived as liberatory in the 1960s. This shift is emblematized in the arrest and incarceration of John Sinclair, founding member of the White Panthers, sometime manager of the MC5, and a role model of sorts for the young Kelley, who came of age in a Detroit suburb and presented himself a scurrilous image of John Dean, counsel to President Nixon, as part of reconstructed history in 1989. Now, these perturbations in the drug imaginary carried over into various forfeits, paranoias, and conspiracy theories, culminating in the sloganizing defeatism with its truthful penumbra of drugs as the weapons against us. Now, I want to underline that my frame of reference today will be limited. I discuss only the works, writings, conceptual context of two artists who moved to Los Angeles from Michigan in the mid-1970s, Jim Shore and Mike Kelley. And I restrict myself to their engagements with psychotropic imagery and visual effects. Further, work on and with drug cultures was not really central, in its own terms at least, to either artist, especially to Kelley. Yet, it is the appositional relation of psychotropic imagery to their larger projects and issues, and questions of how these materials were taken up as assumptions or as tokens of a common currency that make my points of reference. Now, for these reasons, the predicates of my remarks will be quite different, perhaps, from other contributions today that have concentrated on the neurophysiological and or the social or political effects of psychotropic drugs, whether in the 50s or 60s or today, whether in ritual shamanistic settings or in the raves, back alleys, and basements of the global north. Now, I want to argue that some of the most interesting and consequential manifestations of a drug imaginary in the art world are those like Jim Shaw's, seen here, in which psychotropic imagery and experiences are embedded in a much wider critique of ritual utopianism and practices such as Kelley's, in which the formal appearance and some of the motivating aspects of drug-related imagery are reproduced, but, I will argue, deferred and reprojected. The tradition of meta-symbolization to which I'm pointing here is operative in a group of West Coast artists that includes Raymond Pettibon, as you see on screen, but also Paul McCarthy, as you see here, as well as Shaw and Kelley, among others, that has investigated let's call it the symbol formation in religious and mind-altering and para-religious practices. It's present in the spectacles of mediated mega-leisure, such as sitcoms and theme parks, and in modes of symbolic transfer, repressed memory, and situational empathy operative between social subjects and their relational objects. Kelley, in particular, had a long-standing preoccupation with these issues, which he developed in a series of pungent analyses of Catholic rituals, the education of, quote, civic subjects, including himself, and in the symbol formations of amateur productions of various kinds. Now, for Jim Shaw, these concerns eventuated in his extraordinary simulated religion, Oism, in which ecstatic communion, mind transformation, and pseudo-anthropological experiment are conjoined in a two-decade-long multimedia project. The elements of what Shaw described as his fake religion project include a series of Oist student drawings and paintings, Oist spot illustrations, various holes drilled by a certain Malcolm O, an Oist conceptual artist, the ritual of the 360 degrees, a video and associated set of body part musical instruments, the Oist thrift store paintings, Oist religious epic movie stills and associated posters, this work, the Donner Party, an installation made in 2003, a circular table, as you see, with covered wagons topped by sculptures of various kinds, pages from the automatic writing of the Book of O, the Inky Depths, an Oist religious horror comic that turns into a theological debate between the Oist artists who are churning out the comics, plans long in development for a storefront church that evolves from an internet meeting place into a location for the creation of new gospel trance music, and a large series of large historical Oist friezes. It includes this work, a dance video, The Whole, an integrated study in Oist integrated movement from 2009, as well as a series of Oist portraits of children. Now, these elements, along with many other parts and subplots, are organized by a species of delinquent transcendentalism that operates as the implicit reverse and pair of the mental derangements associated with drug-induced vision. As we will see, for Shaw and his protagonists, who assume a range of subject positions that often converge but are never identical, there is a salient continuity between the congregational transcendentalism of evangelical religions and the work and experience of both dreams and psychoactive drugs. According to the artist's elaborate foundation narrative, the fictitious painter who produced the Oist movie posters was an illustrator who attempted to infiltrate generally figurative but specifically facial imagery into the visual repertoire of a religion that, like Islam, Judaism, or early Christianity, prohibited the representation of both human bodies and images of God. The abstract grounds of the posters stand in then for what was programmatically acceptable within Oist theology and aesthetics, but at the same time offer a commentary on what Shaw has referred to as the congealed consolidation of non-figurative modernist style in the years around 1949. On screen here is de Kooning's untitled 1949 top left, with details from the background of two Oist paintings. These are then both mysteriously ineffable Oist firmaments, and as good, quote, as the artist can do without being a sincere abstract expressionist painter. Suggesting the idea of a film without actually making the film, the fake posters tie into movies that relate to signal moments in the history of Oism, beginning with the birth of O herself, the woman with no name. The apogee, or highest point of Oism, before it crashed into the sea, as Shaw put it, is the subject of several poster sets, including the Kill Your Darlings and the Land of the Octopus series from 2003. The final roster is set in the mid-19th century and addresses the creation of Oist scriptures and the loss of control of the religion by its organizing hierarchy, birth of a notion. In Shaw's imagination, the founders and first revisionists of Oism, O and I, originated in another dimension. They didn't so much die as slowly faded away, like jinns or genies, they could somehow be contained, and like movies and genies, they could also be re-released. Now, the predominantly bodiless protagonists of the movie poster paintings, whose features and accoutrements seem to be drawn from film stars of the Gloria Swanson type, though they were, for the most part, modeled and costumed by individuals in the artist's own circle of friends, these should be understood as residual deities or priests and priestesses in the Oist pantheon, organized in groups and clusters that resemble the Christian Holy Trinity, the 12 disciples of the major prophets, or the four heavenly kings adopted into Chinese and Japanese Buddhism from India. But unlike the highly coded symbology of these religious figures established over the course of centuries, the dissimulated gravitas of Shaw's upstart demiurges is signaled by several obvious variables of appearance: deco-era women's hats and headpieces, hairstyling, and in the case of the male deities, the somewhat generically prophetic appearance of beards and facial hair. As you can see, the topmost female head in Kill Your Darlings number 2, for example, wears an apparently jewel-encrusted cap secured under the chin with a broad lace-like tie. Her head is caught in that upward-facing tilt so that her heavenward-gazing eyes reprise the deifying posture historians have associated with portraits of Alexander the Great as he was converted from man to God in one of the earliest defining gestures of apotheosis and epiphany. Now, Shaw offers several suggestive but never quite specific connections between the altered states of mind promoted by his fabricated religion and both historical and contemporary forms of trance, spiritual transcendence, or hallucination. He raises questions, for example, about the entheogenic hypothesis that the use of certain psychoactive substances accentuates or actually engenders religious experience without, I think, either subscribing to or disavowing it. Further, his iconography of ritually garbed floating faces takes on that salient fraction of human corporeality associated with the production and experience of paranormal sensations and the registration of psychotropic or allied effects. In one of his studies of non-ordinary states of consciousness, Stanislav Graf, for example, works through some half a dozen figures of the face as it is perceived or re-envisaged in psychotropic experience, or one or another aspect of what he terms the basic perinatal matrix, the BPM. Perhaps the most dramatic of these arrives in the death-rebirth struggle, as Graf puts it, associated with BMP3. Now, the final paragraph of his subject's recollection of struggle and conflict is staged in a torrent of slimy and slippery biological filth, which might have been amniotic fluid, mucus, blood, secretions. All of this material entered his mouth and penetrated his lungs. He was, in Graf's account, choking, gagging, making faces and spitting, trying to get out of his system and off his skin. Caught up in processes of deeply visceral evacuation, choking, gagging, spitting, the making of faces, even if in reflex grimaces or contortions, seems somewhat out of step with the onrush of pure elemental sensation. But one can read the generation of these primal emotions as a token of reparation, Graf suggests, as his subject learned at birth, but then again in its re-experience, to surrender to the events in train rather than to struggle against them. A process of uncomplication, disendangerment, emblematized by a mode of facial control that would, quote, make his life much easier and more playful than it was before. Connection, I think, with Florencia's remarks earlier today. Now, Graf points to another mode of face projection that is almost the obverse of the traumatic grimace. He recounts how one of his clients, a certain Jenna, registered the effects of experiencing herself merging with her mother while reliving the interuterine and nursing periods of her life. Caught up into a fetal position, characteristic of a person who is, quote, in a deeply repressed, sorry, that is regressed, probably both, anyway, regressed state, he notes that, quote, every wrinkle on her face seemed to disappear as she took on the qualities of a tiny infant who became so close to her mother that she had, quote, a wonderful sense of actually becoming a part of her, merging with her, until there was no difference between her mother's feelings and her own. Here, the face is, as it were, unwritten or de-inscribed, disburdened of its defining marks of age, character, and gender, then smoothed and emptied out further still until it becomes consubstantial with the flesh of its own progenitor. Graf alludes elsewhere to situations in which the self is experienced as a universal archetype, such as the Great Mother, who represents, quote, the essence of motherhood and the qualities of all mothers of the world throughout human history. A little bit of Jung, if you like, going back to our first paper today. The encompassing magnitude of this figure is such that Graf is compelled to conjure it up by mobilizing several analogies, beginning with the simulation of three dimensions in holography. The precise example he cites, however, like the case just discussed, posits a multi-faced child who in effect gives onto a bigger picture of generalized motherhood. Several years ago, he writes, a composite hologram was exhibited in Honolulu. It was called The Child of Hawaii, which was a collection of individual faces of many Hawaiian children coexisting in a single holographic image. Though it actually contained scores of faces, they were all superimposed into what appeared to be a single figure, but which changed, revealing a new face each time you changed your viewing angle or your position. More than anything else, perhaps, Graf's analog resembles descriptions in mystical religious literature. In particular, I think Nicholas de Cusa's De Visioni Dei, the vision of God, that seek to articulate the uncircumscribable transcendence, and in particular, the omnivoyance of the face of God, conceived of as an infinite sphere that can watch everywhere at once, its infinite angles corresponding to the score of faces, if you like, referred to by Graf. Both discourses are also predicated on the potency of the seminal, in which origins are glimpsed in seeds or primary development, and for both, relinquishment is needed to engender proper contact with originary truth. As de Cusa puts it, if then I wish to see the absolute power of all the powers of such seeds, this absolute power is the power that is also the beginning and that gives power to all seeds, I must pass beyond all seminal power. This corresponds to Warren's sex education part of his lecture. I must pass beyond all seminal power that can be known and conceived, and must enter into that ignorance wherein remains no seminal power or seminal force at all. Now, in addition to a reflection during hypnosis on the pain visited on his own face, quote, contorted in a painful spasm when he found himself in the dark primitive workshop of a blacksmith. Now, Graf offered a more developed notion of the potential violence of birth symbolism and certain uses of perinatal language. Citing Sam Keane's The Faces of the Enemy and research by Lloyd de Mouws, he reached again for the darker implication of memories of perinatal trauma, claiming that they play an important role in violent social activity, including war and nuclear conflict. Those who initiate, quote, warring activities are typically substituting external targets for elements in their own psyches that should properly be faced in personal self-exploration, quote. The proper facing mooted here, deliciously ironized, I think, by Kelley in The Enlarged Head of Caricature is like the enlarged head of a fetus, arises from the discovery of and reconciliation with that inevitability of traumatic becoming to which Graf pointed in his BMP analysis, a making over of the face, staging or pulling it into place so that its expression is in accord and at peace with its biogenetic formation. Now, for Shaw, and for Jim Shaw, to some degree for Kelley too, perhaps also for the present discussion and conference, it's crucial that the topography of facial expressions, whether seen as ecstatic, enraptured, hallucinating, or otherwise transported, always betokens the effect of an effect. The face in this condition is a stage for the production of the look of an experience. Transcendental physiognomy, if I could put it like that, thus makes a kind of hermeneutically diminished pair with the rigmaroles of traditional physiognomic analysis, whose precepts date back to the ancient world, in which the proportions and aspects of the face are read and decoded in order to determine the moral or social disposition of the interior subject. In transcendental physiognomy, on the other hand, faces scroll through the ventriloquized performance of a trip, signifying only its rapture or possession. One can generalize, perhaps, about the cardinal points of such a physiognomy, its agony or beatitude. But the mirage of out-of-body experience trumps and re-signifies the calculus of inner disposition. Shaw's work thus draws attention to the conflicted spaces between experience, appearance, and recall, reminding us, as with psychoanalysis, that perhaps more pointedly, that our purchase on the actual shape, composed of narratives, fragments, juxtapositions, part objects, spatio-temporal disequilibrium, many other less definable attributes, these aspects of psychotropic experience, as of dream work, at least where the attempt is made to comprehend or analyze rather than simply have them, that this is necessarily inflected by the conditions and effectiveness of memory, transcription, and redelivery in non-delirious terms. The frictions of these spaces of emergence are, I would argue, analogous in many ways to the social drag of political policy and shifting social values in train in the US in the aftermath of the 1960s. Both are zones of distortion in which the shape of raw or direct experience is shifted, sometimes radically. It is with reference to specific inflections within and across these spaces that Shaw and Kelley, with somewhat different emphases, stage their dialogues with the psychotropic imaginary. Now, Shaw's Oist project intervenes in another key declension of the debate over psychoactive experience, located in the relational matrix between dance, music, and trance. As with the conditions I've already described, Shaw deliberately takes up with a compromised front onto a putatively essential correlation, often present in the ritual settings of drug consumption, whether religious, shaman-assisted, or part of the mass spectacle of contemporary rave or trance cultures. Made in collaboration with the choreographer Anita Pace, Shaw's video, The Whole, subtitled with Mischievous Deadpan, a study in Oist integrated movement, takes as a point of reference aspects of the mass choreography of Busby Berkeley, but crosses it with intimations of religious TV channel infomercials and the mannered self-confidence of an established faith. From one point of view, the piece offers a parody of the elemental algebra of transcendentalism, ricocheting from the plenitude of wholeness and integrated infinity to the zero of Oism itself. From another, Shaw and Pace work to suspend and interrogate the relational conformities between performer and ritual participant, between bodies and contexts, between the erotic and the sacred, between sound, rhythm, and movement. But Shaw's work is permeated by references to drug cultures that date back over 30 years. His most important early work, the series My Mirage, you can see some images here, consists of a voluminous collection of drawings, paintings, and objects attributed to Billy, a persona that Shaw constructed in bricolage fashion out of the consumer and countercultures of the 1960s. Through a sequence of vignettes, the series follows Billy's adolescence in mythical small-town America, his subsequent experiments with hallucinogenic drugs, under the influence of a pagan cult, and his eventual rebirth as a Christian televangelist. It's a complicated work. Now, this piece, I think, is one of the most important attempts in the art world to make sense of the utopian dreams of the 1960s. It's structured around parodic versions of the cultural sources that shape Billy's development, including Marvel Comics, Mad Magazine, Milton Bradley's The Game of Life, B and film noir movies, Dali's painting, rock posters, and drug rituals. Shaw also made a four-part videotape, Billy Goes to a Party, in 1986, in which he follows Billy, as you can tell, to a party where he experiments with drugs and has hallucinations that are based on his favorite horror movies. The various grids of yearbook photos of Billy's female contemporaries in the Girls in Billy's Class series, 86 to 87, from My Mirage, exemplify, I think, the different regimens of Shaw's tongue-in-cheek etiquette of symbolic facial replacement. The first installment correlates a relatively homogeneous and real-looking group of high school girls with period coiffures and attire, actually based on Mike Kelley's junior high school yearbook photos, each in three-quarter profile, facing slightly to the left, with 16 religious denominations ranging from Methodist and Greek Orthodox to Seventh-day Adventist and Jehovah's Witness. In number two, each of the 16 seemingly ecstatic or zoned-out faces is labeled with a type of recreational, sedative, hypnotic, analgesic, or psychoactive drug, including meth, smack, heroin, acid, LSD, peyote, mescaline, hash, mushrooms, STP, serenity, tranquility, and peace, PCP, lewds, downers, depressants, including barbiturates and opioids, or with over-the-counter drugs, codeine, or common nicotine, caffeine, booze, and low-dosage stimulants, such as strychnine, in higher concentrations, of course, a neurotoxin. Number three features images of nine young... Number three features images of nine young women mixed with six men, including a pistol-toting James Bond, as well as a chimp sporting a blonde wig. Each photograph is captioned with a slogan-like phrase taken from various psychological imperatives drawn from the popular cultural politics of the late 1960s, including self-improvement, dropping out, self-pleasuring, etc. You are what you eat, keep on trucking. If it feels good, do it. Now, the two final iterations of these complex identity multiples offer further dimensions of surrogacy and substitution. In Girls in Billy's Class number four here, which bears the parenthetical subtitle Self-Portrait 4, head and shoulder portraits are replaced by a range of objectifying household items, including an electric can opener, dish rack, bowl and lemon press, each labeled with a girl's first name, while the fifth and final variant reverts to the normative visual format of number one, but pairs each portrait with one or the other side of a terrifying binary, as their lives and destinies are inscribed alternatively as lost or saved. The lost, in point of fact, are members of Charles Manson's family. The saved, student nurses from the South Chicago Community Hospital, who were tortured and murdered by Richard Benjamin Speck in July 1966. Denominated in grids whose subdivisions emblematize, literally and metaphorically, the ritual-inflected coming of age of their protagonists, these works scramble the singular identities of their sundry sweet 16s into a plurality of defined and competitive religious or social conditions. They unhinge them with a cocktail of mind-altering addictive drugs, reduce them to specious kinds of domestic objectivity, and further diminish their manifestly uneven struggles for identity by besetting them with a fusillade of vague and often contradictory mantras of narcissistic betterment, teenage abandon, and religious salvation. Now, while the girls in Billy's class series relies on exaggerated yet ordered proliferation and multiplicity, offering a kind of formula for the implication of a whole community in highly specific substrates of religious, domestic, and mind-altering experience, Shaw also developed a theory about the structural relation between dreams and DMT. This is Shaw. The vast majority of dreams, he said, are anxiety related. But every now and again, you'll get some sort of visionary dream. Shaw continued, I believe that dreams and DMT are basically the same substance, and that you're assessing the same thing through different things, meditation, drugs. I've got to the point where I can access that same state just through listening to this mechanical device called a holosync. But I think you can get apps for the iPhone that are supposed to do the same thing. It works best for me if I have a problem to solve, if I have a partial idea for a piece. It doesn't work so well if I don't have an idea yet. Now, the contention that Shaw makes here for a homogeneous relationship, or at least a continuity, between dream work and psychoactive experience, and again, with, quote, descriptions I've read about the Holy Spirit that can envelop ecstatic Christians, those are Shaw's words, these arise from one of the most fastidious attempts ever made in the art world to document, record, and then repicture dream experience. With the aid of his dream diaries that he's kept for 3.5 decades, Shaw has unleashed a cascade of dream drawings, most of them organized, as you see here, in the cell-like subdivisions associated with the comic strip, accompanied in most instances by elaborate descriptive title texts. Now, interestingly, Shaw relates the scrambled obscurity of dreams to linguistic and imagistic structures, including wordplay and symbol formation, symbolization. I think, he says, dreams and visions speak in various degrees of occlusion, using puns and symbols, and puns as symbols. Some dreams are in direct response to recent problems one encounters, others relate to long-term troubles. A lot of dreams are like spam emails. A few are prophetic. At the same time, he acknowledges the more radical ego-eliminating effects of DMT and the experience of a kind of pre-linguistic oblivion. I experienced ego death, he writes, on mushrooms, in which DMT is the active ingredient. But a weird after-effect of that is that one is forced to reconstruct the ego from scratch, which ironically makes you solipsistically into a center of the universe for that process, which can in turn make you a potential Manson or follower. Now, the after effects to which Shaw refers here relate quite precisely to those alluded to in the title of my talk, a product of the rebound from evacuation on the way down from the high of a trip. They stand in for the space between a holotropic state of mind and a normal experience. But as the former is relinquished and the latter heralded and then reattained, they thus betoken not the unraveling of a hylotropic state of consciousness, but its reconstitution. Now, research into the effects of psychoactive substances and the emergence of deep consciousness has often emphasized what Graf described as the yearning, quote, for a state of total fulfillment, such as that which can be experienced in a good womb or in a mystical rapture, an experience of need that, quote, appeared to the subject guided into the altered state about whom he reported, that appeared to be the ultimate motivating force of every human being. Graf's account specifically links this primal experience to three conditions. The theme of yearning expressed in the unfolding of fairy tales toward a happy ending, one. Second, the revolutionary's dream of a utopian future. And thirdly, the artist's drive, surprisingly perhaps, for acceptance and acclamation, for fame. Now, I'm interested not so much in challenging or disturbing the validity of these claims, which does need disturbing, but I'm interested more in pointing to the formatting of the connectivity and desire on which they're predicated, the yearning, the dream, and the drive. How these volitions are staged in what is often seen or felt as counter-voluntaristic experience, and how their almost mundane striving, sensed particularly perhaps in how Graf frames the ambition or will to fame of the artist, seems already to have implicated holotropic experience in the contaminating contingencies of the normative world. But Graf's emphasis on mythology, utopianism, and creativity does help us to understand how these larger questions operate, not in or out of altered states of consciousness, but on the way in or out of them. So my interest is thus not in the unfathomability of a certain wholeness. The chapter from which I've cited Graf is titled Wholeness and the Amniotic Universe. My interest is not there, but it rather in guidance devices and their relinquishment, whether material, conceptual, or ideological. We encounter one of these, by definition unreliable, in the plausibly fabricated reconstruction of integrated movement that we saw in Shaw's version of the whole, complete with its situational ironies and punning deflation of the space between all or nothing. Now, as part of his research for the ongoing Oism project, Shaw joined a closed ayahuasca ceremony near Los Angeles a few years ago, returning on several occasions. His experiences passed into the Oism series in a number of interesting and possibly controversial ways. I cannot address here the detail of Shaw's claims about the relationship between DMT and dreams, nor, of course, the wider literature in which this question is debated, though more often evaded. But one observation seems important, that Shaw is especially interested in the reflexive feedback between discourses and experience. Many of his dream drawings represent various interfaces between dreaming and artwork, or the art world, and more occasionally, hallucinatory and psychotropic experience themselves. It is presumably to one of these recursive relationships that the artist refers when, in articulating the continuity between dreams and DMT, he notes that his own frame of mind as an artist, and in particular, his self-conscious reflection about an artistic problem, in quotes, acts as a triggering mechanism for an art-oriented, quote, solution. The explicit voluntarism offered here, based on the drive for aesthetic resolution, represents another of Shaw's redirections of unconscious experience using prompts and particulars drawn from combinations of his artistic and everyday selfhoods. This is another gesture that tempers or canalizes the imminence of out-of-body experience and helps to indicate how trips themselves may have stumbled on through the 1970s. I'm running out of time. I'm just going to say a few remarks. I won't be able to get to Mike Kelley very much, but I'll throw out some images, some ideas, and we'll catch up with that another time. Let me say that Kelley's interest in hallucinogenic and drug cultures is less consistent and focused than Shaw's, but it does, I think, raise a host of questions which he posed throughout his working life, from the early performances, 76 through 86, through to his crazy inflatable that you see here, Sex, Drugs, and Rock and Roll Party Palace from 2009. Now, Kelley, Shaw, and myself touch on some of these issues in a long interview that we published as the book on screen on The Beyond in 2011, in which Kelley connected the psychedelic imagery which intrigued him throughout his career with the failed projects of 60s radicalism, including the hippie and later the yippie ethos. At the same time, he takes up with his own version of, quote, projected reconstructions. That, I will argue, is a kind of substitute for psychotropic distortion. Now, some of Kelley's concerns converge with Shaw's, as with the investigation of adolescent experiments with psychedelia in junior high school notebook cover, which you see on screen here. Others involve his discussion in a collaborative lecture with Dietrich Dietrichson at Documenta 10 of the negotiation by the Yippies, the White Panthers, and other groups between radical politics and drug taking in his home and university towns of Detroit and Ann Arbor, Michigan. He also discusses the nexus of relations between UFOs, alien incorporation, science fiction cinema, and psychedelia in his wonderful essays on UFOlogy, and of a collaboration with Raymond Pettibone on the album Torches and Standards from 1990, which included the Stoners of Venice, a Jim Morrison-esque poetic rant recited over an improvised psychedelic jam. In an early interview, Kelley summarized these influences, noting that he actually developed his interest in installation and performance work, in noise, music, and multimedia installation by way, quote, of popular psychedelia. He underlined the contention a few years later. When I was in my early teens, I got into the radical underground. I was into psychedelic posters and underground comics, and I began to have a more self-conscious understanding of art. By the time I was a senior in high school, I took it seriously. And I'm going to end there, but I just want to show you silently, without me talking over them, some Kelley images that I would have talked about. I want to end because he has a very interesting discussion of Dalí and utopian architecture in relation to countercultural drug phenomena. This relation. Yeah, I have to go quick because we've got to allow our last speaker some time. I want to end with, we're just going very quickly over some stuff here. I want to end with one image that comes up. Sorry, there were more images than I thought. But that's what I want to end with. Very remarkable conjunction, I think, between Kelley's nostalgic depiction of childhood. It's not an installation, it's actually a photograph. and then one of the most extraordinary of the anti-drug, anti-LSD propaganda films made by state governments in the United States in the 60s and 70s. With that, thank you.